Good morning. Today is February 23rd, 2024. I'm Douglas Burton, and this is Design Diet, a nutritious exploration of today's leading design innovations in the Pacific Northwest. Today, we welcome Mariana Sanchez, a scenic designer with a background in architecture based in the New York City area. She earned her MFA in scenic design from the Yale School of Drama and recently was chosen as the scenic designer for the play Unseen at the Shakespeare Theater Festival in Ashland, Oregon. Mariana, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Douglas. Thank you so much for having me.
I see that you're joining us from London today.
Yeah, I am here. I've been living here for the last 6 months, and I have still other 6 months to go. I am doing an MA in painting right now at the Royal College of Art.
Very nice. Yeah. Well, we appreciate you taking the time. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about scenic design. I've been a fan of the theater for as long as I can remember. My first memories going as a child were ones of an entire visual world opening up to me for the first time. What struck me most about productions was the scenic design. It created a dreamlike setting where I could escape into another world filled with fantasy, sometimes horror, humor, and more. And what you created in the play Unseen at the Oregon Shakespeare Theater Festival, in my opinion, was quite an accomplishment. I was thoroughly impressed with the visual layers of texture, form, translucency, and imagery that immediately brought me into the moment. So my first question for you is, can you explain to our listeners how the scenic designer originally starts the process with the director, the lighting designer, the actors, and the script?
Sure. First, we do a reading of the play, and we spend some time, maybe some weeks, talking about the play all together. At this point, the actors are still not part of this process. This is only the creative team and sometimes the playwright. From that point, I go to my board and I start bringing some ideas, some research. To the director, sometimes to the team, it depends on how the director wants to work, really it's his lead or her lead. In this case, for Unseen, I brought the first sketches for the director, and from there, he was very excited about the general idea, and we continue to develop the design. Then lighting and projection design get on board more deeply in how their work is going to be affected by the world that I'm creating.
I see.
But yeah, that's the general idea.
Would you say it's truly a collaboration between all of these groups? Are you able, for example, to take your vision from beginning to end without any changes or edits?
No. It has never happened to me that I start with one idea that doesn't change, which I think it's good because it definitely gets much more richer as the process goes. And it is a truly collaborative process. Theater is a super complex machine that everybody has an important role in. And it's almost like a puzzle that by the end of the process, everything fits together. So everybody has a say on it.
I love that image. Yeah, that's a great way to describe it. What part of the collaboration would you say you find most interesting? I'm sure you must learn something new along the way that surprises you.
Yeah, for sure. I love the conceptual part of the process. Because it's when we are discussing big ideas and when we are really trying to understand human nature. But then when we go into the rehearsal process with the actors, you get into the meatier place of the characters, and you start understanding much deeper how every actor is giving it life. And so it's a... How do I say? It's like a tennis play where I throw something into the game and then I get something back. And it's just like that. Yeah, I would say the conceptual part for me is the most fun part of the process.
Yeah, I love how you described it as a tennis match. What I find so fascinating about theater is how the scenic designer can transport the viewer from one time period to another, all through the interplay of that three-dimensional design that you create. They can choose to base the play in the time period it was written, for example, or recreate the set to evoke another time period altogether. I noticed that, like, for example, video projection, music, lighting, props, the projected words all play a part in this. So where does your work start and end, and the music technician or the lighting designer's work pick up, for example?
Yeah, I am in the earliest part of the process. Well, once the play is written, of course. So I would say that I work on the design, and once the director is happy with this general idea, then I bring it to the table, and in other creative collaborators of the process start jumping in. And it gets to a point where almost the design gets, it's like the life by itself. When I get into the theater, there's not much I can do because by that point, everybody is involved. And if I make a little change, like everybody has to change things. Mm. So during the tech period, for example, that is when we're all together in the theater, definitely lighting, projection, and sound, they really have the work in their hands. Actors, the director.
I'm assuming you don't really get a say in the other creative people involved in what they're doing. Or you mentioned earlier that it really is a collaborative process. Do you find that the other creative people involved, the lighting designer, the costume designer, are they all amenable to your ideas mostly?
Yeah, I've had in general very good experiences about the collaboration, and we have to collaborate because my set is going to have an effect in how the projections work, and finally we are all working trying to create one world that is cohesive. I do have opinions when scenery is affected directly, but much of the contact itself, it's already decided with the director. So it's more about the visual that I have an opinion than really what is the content of the work.
I see. What I remember the most from, in addition to your set from the play when I was down in Ashland, were the projected words that appeared at the top of the set that added so beautifully to the storyline. Was that your idea?
I mean, it was a collaboration. That is a good example because we knew that we needed to have subtitles, but we took into account that the play is talking about how we see the war from our screens or from the TV, for example. So we wanted to create this distance between the audience and the action. So by creating this frame that was separating that, we had that space that served as the space for the projections. So it conceptually it made also sense. Yeah.
Yes, I thought it was incredibly clever. I was so moved by that. In fact, the other part of the production I was especially moved by were moments in the play where the actors stopped speaking and the lighting dimmed and these stunning video projections filled the set and moved across the actors' faces and the set pieces. First of all, was that something that you worked in collaboration with the lighting designer, and how did you all come up with that idea?
I mean, the projections was mostly Caitlin Pietras, who's an amazing projection designer. But conceptually, we were all together and bringing up these ideas. What is interesting about On Scene in particular is that we didn't want to have transitions where we could see people like moving the furniture around or the props around or any scenic movements that would distract from the storytelling. Also, because the play, we were taking into account that it was through Mia's eyes. And so basically we were trying to portray her mind in a way. So that was, we needed to create it, or we were trying to create this blurriness between her memories and the reality.
That's such a great way to describe it, between her memories and the reality. And so the video projections were a way for you to both create this ethereal memory, which is what you just mentioned, but also a way to move different set pieces around without the audience being distracted.
Yeah, and also taking into account that she, the main character, she's a war journalist. So we wanted to bring to life her pictures, her war pictures into the set.
I see. Mariana, I also noticed that the translucency you created of different layers in the set design, that was really fascinating to me. What types of materials does a scenic designer use to create different layers that at one point can be opaque and at another point be translucent to show something behind a scrim, for example, that's not evident at the start of a play?
Well, this is really very simple. It's the scrim, as you say, and the scrim with the light, and depending where the light hits the scrim, can create beautiful scenic moments where, depending if the light is, for example, front of the scrim, you won't see what's happening behind. But if the light suddenly changes, and then you create this transition from one to the other, it's like magic in front of your eyes. I think it's one of the most simplest but magical moments of theater.
I think that's a perfect way to describe it. It was magical. I remember seeing this play for the first time, and I was truly moved. I got chills over my body when I saw both the set that you did, the projected video, and those layers of translucency and opacity in the design. It was really quite moving to me. The broken computer monitors and also what looked like trash and rubble from war-torn countries, I'm assuming those were also used as props. I found that really projected the essence of what the play was about. Where did you find these props in such a small town like Ashland, Oregon?
It was actually quite simple because it was just a lot of distressing, really. And you can find a lot of things on the internet, like eBay and things like that. Yeah, it wasn't difficult at all. A lot of the destruction and the rubble, it was just literally breaking some gray blocks and drawing on paper and then tea dyeing and burning and, yeah, distressing. And then also, because everything is leaving behind the screen, there's a blurriness of the image. That helps.
And were you the one who was actually breaking the computers into pieces and the blocks and the tea dyeing, like you mentioned, or do you have a team that does that for you?
OSF has an amazing props team, and they have a huge props warehouse. So they are in charge. Basically, you give just the research image, but you can be involved. For example, I was involved more in the drawings and the things that were... the kids' drawings and how much of that distressing I wanted to take on.
And that actually preempts my other question, which was, you pretty much answered it, which is you must have to mix pieces from yard sales, items that are donated, upcycled props that you clean and paint. But you already mentioned eBay, and I did not realize the Oregon Shakespeare Festival has a large warehouse filled with old props that you can reconfigure for your purposes.
Yeah, it's an amazing warehouse. Huge.
Oh, I would love that. Now, that is something I would love to see. I bet you they would have a great yard sale if they ever opened up that place to the public.
I think they have one of the biggest custom storage, too. They rent.
Oh, do they? Okay.
Custom all over the U.S.
Yeah. Oh, they rent their props to other theatrical productions around the United States?
I don't know the details exactly. It depends on the production, but sometimes they travel from one place to the other.
So you must have spent quite some time rummaging through the warehouse to find pieces that fit this production.
Yeah, and it's a lot of trying and error. You choose something, then you bring it to the rehearsal room and it doesn't work, and then it's just like...
I noticed that after looking at other productions that you've designed through my research, I noticed that there's a very clear style that is uniquely your own. How I would describe it is quite moody. It's somewhat ephemeral, almost dreamlike. Where did you originally find your inspiration to work in such a creative field? Or what would you say is your signature style in your productions?
It's difficult for me to recognize my style because I am always fighting against my style, if that makes sense. I don't want to repeat myself. But I do think that I have a background in architecture. I studied in Mexico architecture and I worked some years there. And I think that I have a very strong sense for what architecture should be. I don't know, I studied during a period where minimalism and brutalism in architecture was very strong. And I think that I've brought that into my set design. But at the same time, I'm always trying to not challenge myself and fighting against those rules. But I think sometimes it's impossible.
Well, having grown up in Mexico, you must have had some inspiration, like you just mentioned, from both minimalism and brutalism in architecture. I mean, in all of the creative industries, wherever you are born and spend most of your time, one can not help but be inspired by architecture, design, landscape, graphic design, art of the period one grows up in.
Exactly.
You know, I bet most of our listeners do not realize that somebody in the United States can get a degree in scenic design. Can you describe the difference to our listeners between scenic design, set design, and production design?
Yeah, production design is designing for TV and movies. And scenic design and set design is basically the same. It's designing for the stage. And it can be theater, opera, ballet, any live performance.
So scenic design and set design are synonymous.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, also English is not my first language, but it's the same.
Well, your English is much better than my Spanish, that's for sure.
Thanks.
Because you're working with limited space in a theater, how does a scenic designer trick the viewer's eye into creating depth, angles, and volumes in that three-dimensional space? There must be certain tricks of the trade that all scenic designers know.
I mean, definitely there are tricks. It depends so much on the space itself. So for example, talking specifically about on scene, this is a black box where we had the chance to decide where the seating arrangements would be. And because of the spot that we had during the season, we had the luxury of not having to worry about the other productions that were going to be happening at the same time. So we decided to go for this alley disposition of the set, which creates a very profound depth in the stage. It really depends on the concept of the play again, but we wanted to create this kind of other space that would be the metaphor of her mental state, right? So that's why it's so deep. There are definitely tricks where you can use the lines of the architecture and sharpen them into, a perspective point and make them exaggerate them. But it's tricky. Tricky because then the actor, the presence of the actor, is always going to be in comparison to those points. So it's a trick between reality and magic, right?
Well, so what you're really talking about here is the horizontal nature. When you said the alley that you created this set designed to be reminiscent of an alley. When I first saw it, I felt it had this very horizontal nature to it. Looking from left to right, you'd created decades of this person's life in this almost this alley horizontal construction.
Yeah. So basically, alleys, there's audience, then there's a space in between, and there's another set of audience that are facing each other. So that way we created this long space in between the two of them.
So beautiful. You know, to me, scenic design is a mix of architecture, interior design, visual art, visual merchandising, performance art, visual art. I think I said visual art twice. Your work is so reminiscent.
Yeah.
Your work is so reminiscent of other artists I've seen. You must have been inspired throughout your life by other creative people in the industry. Can you describe to our listeners where you find your inspiration?
I'm constantly looking at art, especially, I mean, I am studying painting, so I am a big fan of two-dimensional paintings. And I do get inspired by painting as a composition that then can be brought into a three-dimensional space as the theater. On the other hand, when I am designing a set, I try to not take direct references of other productions. I really try to go to the original source of research. So real pictures of places and sometimes literature. In this case, we were very inspired by a book that is called War is a Force That Gives Us Meaning by Chris Hedges. And he explained very powerful the experience of a war journalist. So inspiration can come from anywhere, really, for designing a set. Because once you have the concept, then you're trying to bring those concepts into the architecture.
I've always wondered, does the scenic designer oversee the construction of the set itself? Meaning, are you involved in the actual building of the set? Or do you stay for the first few weeks of the production to make sure the set is working smoothly alongside the actors?
In the case of for the Oregon Shakespeare Festival, I'm normally not part of the construction part of the set. Oregon Shakespeare Festival has an amazing production team, and they have technical directors who, once I deliver the drawings and the models and front elevations of a design, they design it structurally to be structurally safe for the play. So there's a lot of back and forth, but really, I am in charge of the visual part of the set, and then there's another team that is in charge of the safety of the set. I do several visits, and I am in the theater during the tech period, and maybe some days before.
I see. Okay, I've always wondered how that works. I find it so fascinating what goes on behind the scenes. I'm assuming in your education, you must have had to have learned CAD, Revit, and SketchUp programs to create the drawings to then give to the technical team.
Yes. I mean, since architecture, I was working in AutoCAD. And it was a nice surprise when I started studying scenic design that a lot was being done by hand, because I hated spending so much time in the computer. And but now with the pandemic and now with Zoom, everything has gone to be like a lot of 3D work in the computer is happening because it's just easier to share.
Yeah, yeah. I can imagine.
Yeah.
Oh, I can imagine. Everything's so global now. Everything's done over Zoom. Tell our listeners what you're working on next. I know you mentioned that you're in London painting. Are you considering changing careers, or do you think you might go back to scenic design sometime in the future?
No, I really want to go back. I mean, to scenic design, I want to do both things. I just want to be more careful in the amount of work that I take and have a more calibrated life. So I am not 50% or a lot of the time outside my house and my family.
I think that's a great way to live. We could all use.
But I think two things complement. Yeah, exactly. That's the difficult part.
You were going to say two things complement.
Oh, that painting and set design, I think they complement each other very well, because in a way I feel that in painting, I am creating also worlds with narratives. So I think it's gonna have a good application later on.
Well, the narrative of the show today is Mariana's work is stunning, and I'm so thrilled to have the opportunity to speak with you today. I was so incredibly impressed with your design for the play, and I truly thank you for joining us today. To learn more about Mariana's work, please visit her website at www.marianasanchezdesign.com. Mariana, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Douglas.
You've been listening to Design Diet, where the content is always fresh, never frozen. Whether savory or sweet, it's bound to hit the spot. Join us next week when we discuss industrial design with the duo Studio Gorm from Eugene, Oregon, and how their product design is bursting onto the scene internationally. Join us.